Hello, warm welcome from Dr. Sushma Singh on this podcast. Today's topic is Consequences of Shock Therapy, Chapter 2, The End of Bipolarity. Let's start. The shock therapy administered in 1990s did not lead the people into the promised utopia of mass consumption. Generally, it brought ruins to the economies and the disaster upon the people of the entire region. In Russia, the large state controls industrial complex almost collapsed, as about 90% of its industries were put up for sale to private individuals and companies. Since the restructuring was carried out through market forces and not by government-directed industrial policies, it led to the virtual disappearance of entire industries. This was called the largest garage sale in history, as valuable industries were undervalued and sold at throwaway prices. Though all citizens were given vouchers to participate in the sales, most citizens sold their vouchers in the black market because they needed the money. The value of the ruble and the Russian currency declined dramatically. The rate of inflation was so high that people lost all their savings. The collective farm system disintegrated, leaving the people without food security, and Russia started to import food. The real GDP of Russia in 1999 was below what it was in 1989. The old trading structure broke down with no alternative in its place. The old system of social welfare was systematically destroyed. The withdrawal of government subsidies pushed large sections of people into poverty. The middle classes were pushed to the periphery of the society, and the academic and intellectual manpower disintegrated or migrated. A mafia emerged in most of these countries and started controlling many economic activities. Privatization led to new disparities. Post-Soviet states, especially Russia, were divided between rich and poor regions, unlike the earlier system. There was now great economic inequality between people. The construction of democratic institutions was not given the same attention and priority as the demands of economic transformation. The constitutions of all these countries were drafted in a hurry, and most, including Russia, had a strong executive president with the widest possible power that rendered elected parliaments relatively weak. In Central Asia, the presidents had great powers, and several of them became very authoritarian. For example, the presidents of Turkmenistan and Uzbekistan appointed themselves to power first for 10 years and then extended it for another 10 years. They allowed no dissent or opposition. A judicial culture and independence of judiciary was yet to be established in most of these countries. Most of these economies, especially Russia, started reviving in 2000, 10 years after their independence. The reason for the revival for most of their economies was export of natural resources like oil, natural gas and minerals. Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, Russia, Turkmenistan and Uzbekistan are major oil and gas producers. Other countries have gained because of the oil pipelines that cross their territories for which they get rent. Some amount of manufacturing has restarted. Now let us discuss tensions and conflicts. Most of the former Soviet republics are prone to conflicts and many have had civil wars and insurgencies. Complicating the picture is the growing involvement of outside powers. In Russia, two republics, Chechnya and Dagestan, have had violent secessionist movement. Moscow's method of dealing with the Chechnya rebels and indiscriminate military bombings have led to many human rights violations but failed to deter the aspirations for independence. In Central Asia, Tajikistan witnessed a civil war that went on for 10 years till 2001. The region as a whole had many sectarian conflicts. In Azerbaijan's province of Nagorno-Karabakh, some local Armenian want to skate and join Armenia. In Georgia, the demand for independence had come from two provinces, resulting in a civil war. There are movements against the existing regime in Ukraine, Kazakhstan and Georgia. Countries and provinces are fighting over river waters. All this had led to instability, making life difficult for the ordinary citizen. The Central Asian republics are areas with vast hydrocarbon resources, which have brought them economic benefit. Central Asia has also become a zone of competition between outside powers and oil companies. The region is next to Russia, China, Afghanistan, and Pakistan, and close to West Asia. After 11 September 2001, the US wanted military bases in the region and paid the governments of all Central Asian states to hire bases and to allow airplanes to fly over their territory during the wars in the Afghanistan and Iraq. However, Russia perceives these states as its near abroad and believes that they should be under Russian influence. China has interests here because of the oil resources, and the Chinese have begun to settle around the borders and conduct trade. In the Eastern Europe, Czechoslovakia split peacefully into two, with the Czechs and the Slovakia forming independent countries. But the most severe conflict took place in Balkan Republic of Yugoslavia. After 1991, it broke apart with several provinces like Croatia, Slovenia, and Bosnia and Herzegovina declaring independence. Ethnic Serbs opposed this, and a massacre of non-Serb Bosnia followed. The NATO intervention and the bombing of Yugoslavia followed the inter-ethnic civil war. Now let us discuss about this. India and post-communist countries. India has maintained good relationship with all the post-communist countries, but the strongest relation are still those between Russia and India. India's relation with Russia are an important aspect of Indian foreign policy. Indo-Russian relationships are embedded in a history of trust and common interest, and are matched by popular perceptions. Indian heroes from the Raj Kapoor to Amitabh Bachchan are household names in Russia and many post-Soviet countries. One can hear Hindi film songs all over the region, and India is part of the popular memory. Russia and India share a vision of a multipolar world order. What they mean by a multipolar world order is the coexistence of several powers in the international system. Collective security, in which an attack on any country is regarded as a threat to all countries and requires a collective response. Greater regionalism, negotiated settlements of international conflicts, and independent foreign policy for all countries and decision making through bodies like UN that should be strengthened, democratized, and empowered. More than 80 bilateral agreements have been signed between India and Russia as part of Indo-Russian Strategic Agreement of 2001. India stands to benefit from its relationship with Russia on the issue like Kashmir, energy supplies, sharing information on international terrorism, access to Central Asia, and balancing its relation with China. Russia stands to benefit from this relationship because India is the second largest arms market for Russia. The Indian military gets most of its hardware from Russia. Since India is an oil importing nation, Russia is important to India and has repeatedly come to the assistance of India during its oil crisis. India is seeking to increase its energy import from Russia, and the republics of Kazakhstan and Turkmenistan. Cooperation with these republics includes partnership and investment in oil fields. Russia is important for India's nuclear energy plants and assisted India's space industry by giving, for example, the cryogenic rocket when India needed it. Russia and India have collaborated on various scientific projects. Our next and last point is Arab Spring. The 21st century witnessed emergence of new developments for democracies and the democratization in West Asian countries. One such event is characterized as Arab Spring that began in 2009. Located in Tunisia, the Arab Spring took its roots where the struggle against corruption, unemployment and poverty was started by the republic, which turned into a political movement because the people considered the existing problems as outcomes of the autocratic dictatorship. The demand for democracy that started in Tunisia spread throughout the Muslim-dominated Arab countries in West Asia. Hosni Mubarak, who had been in power in Egypt since 1979, also collapsed as a result of the massive democratic protests. In addition, the influence of Arab Spring could not be seen in Yemen, Bahrain, Libya, and Syria, where similar protests by the people led to democratic awakening throughout the region. With this, we have come to the end of this chapter. Thanks for great listening.